Hi, my name is Nuno, and we are here to talk now about channel-based audio. There are several flavors of audio. In this video, we are going to focus on channel-based audio, starting from stereo and then go into immersive. So, let's start. If you want to have some kind of space in terms of audio, the most basic is, of course, using stereo, using two speakers. What you do is, if you send the exact same audio to both speakers, what is going to happen is that you're going to perceive the sound as coming from the center, creating this kind of a phantom image. It looks like the sound is coming from the center in between the speakers, but actually there is anything there. There are two speakers, left and right, playing the exact same thing. And then, if you want to send more signal to one speaker or the other, you can actually make that sound, the perception of the sound, to move from the center to one of the speakers more in one direction or the other. The other thing, also quite important, is that when we're working with stereo, you usually have this 60-degree angle, this perfect triangle between the speakers and you. And why 60 degrees? Well, first of all, we want this angle to be as wide as possible. Of course, if we can have a larger sound image, we want to take advantage of that. The problem is that if you start to increase this angle too much and you start to spread those speakers too much between them, at some point, for instance, 90 degrees, what is going to happen is that instead of you having the perception of a sound coming from the middle, actually you're going to start listening to two sounds, one coming from the left, another coming from the right, and nothing coming from the center, which means that you are breaking the stereo image. You get sounds on the sides and nothing coming in the middle. So we need to open this as much as we can, like 60 degrees, but not much more than that, or you're going to break that sound image. Also, at some point, people decided, okay, let's add one additional speaker, a center speaker between left and right. And the question is, why? Because we have just seen that with left and right, it's more than enough for you to place any sound in between those speakers. Why do you need another speaker over there? Well, essentially, it's because the world is not the perfect place, and in spatial audio, that means not everyone is on the sweet spot. For instance, if you go to a movie theater, yes, a few lucky ones are able to stay on the sweet spot, but sometimes some are too close to the screen, or the screen is very large. So eventually, the left and right, that usually are on the edges of the screen, may create an angle that is too wide, more than 60 degrees, and of course, as we have seen, that breaks the sound experience. So having this center channel acts almost like an anchor in terms of sound image, and allows you, if you are especially too close to the screen and more than 60 degrees between left and right, to actually continue to have a good sound experience. On top of that, having one additional speaker, it's better in terms of coloration, because you get a better sound if you use this speaker instead of using a virtual center with both speakers. Also, at some point, especially in the movie industry, they decided, okay, we have stereo, we are now having sound in front of us, but wouldn't it be nice if you could also have the perception of sounds coming to the sides and from the back? So that's the idea of surround speakers. Of course, in the beginning, it was what was called left, center, right surround, which means that you only had one channel that were being reproduced by both surround speakers. They would play exactly the same thing. But then later on with 5.1, you start to have a channel for left surround, another for right surround. And of course, this allows you now to get a sense of sound coming everywhere around you. Also, one of the things that you may notice is that when you go to a movie theater, actually there isn't one left surround speaker and one right surround, but actually an array of speakers. You go to a movie theater in 5.1 or 7.1, and you go there and see on the sides and on the back several speakers there. Although there are several speakers there in these kind of rooms, what they're doing is they are playing the same thing. So you have pretty much the side, left side, and half of the rear playing the left surround, and then the right side and the right side of the rear playing the right surround signal. So imagine that you are, like in this image, imagine you are on the sweet spot and you would add only one channel, one speaker, for each one of those channels. It would be great, okay, no problems. But now imagine that you are in this blue position. And essentially you would get, okay, you have sound pretty much in the back on the right side and nothing coming from the left. Or eventually imagine that you are on the last row of the cinema and everything happens in front of you. If you change these for an array, okay, as you see on this image, now, yes, all the blue speakers are playing the same thing or the purple ones are playing the same thing, but it doesn't matter where you are still completely surrounded by sound, and this gives you a better, much more better experience, especially if you are not on the sweet spot. Also, at some point, the movie industry decided, okay, we need more low frequencies, you know, get this sense of explosion, earthquakes, feeling the body like these rumbles. So how can we achieve this? Of course, the obvious approach would be, okay, let's have larger speakers, let's have more power on our amplifiers. And pretty much now, if we have these loudspeakers, because the problem with low frequencies is that the human ear is not very sensible to it, so you need a huge amount of SPL levels, a lot of sound, for your ear to beginning to listen to some of those frequencies, which means that you need a lot of power. So, bigger speakers, more amplifiers, that will do it, right? Well, not really. At that time, remember, we were still using analog sound, not digital one. It means that we have a very limited dynamic range. And by having this limited dynamic range, if now we start to amplify everything much more, because you need that for the low frequencies, which means that now the dialogues will need to be placed at a lower level because everything is now amplified. And by doing that, since you are amplifying everything, dynamic range is limited, the noise, the background noise will start to go up, and then you're going to start to have noise affecting dialogue, and you don't do that. You don't want that. So the best solution at the moment from the engineering point of view is, okay, let's try something different. Let's create a channel only for low frequency effects, okay? Let's have that channel being reproduced by a subwoofer, because in terms of low frequencies, we are not very sensible to the direction of sound, so which means that a single speaker can create these low frequencies without you losing the sense of space. And then what you do is, you know that this special channel with low frequencies, it's going to need to be reproduced much louder than all the other channels. So all the other channels stay at the same levels, the same dynamic range as everything was before, but now this low frequency effect are going to be reproduced 10 dB louder than anything else. So you get much more sound in low frequencies, allowing audiences to get these rumbles, these earthquake kind of sounds, but at the same time without affecting the dynamic range of dialogues and all other things. So this is pretty much what it was, the solution that actually allowed the creation of this 0.1, the .1 kind of system. Also, when you're talking about LFE and subwoofer, sometimes people tend to use the same expression to both things. The best approach is to call LFE to the audio channel that brings all of this material, and then we call subwoofer to the speaker itself that reproduces all of these low frequencies. So during times there were several flavors happening in terms after 5.1. At some point there was something called Sony SDDS that was a system from Sony with seven speakers, five in the front. It was mainly created for theaters with a large screen. And then at some point, Dolby created a 6.1 with one additional surround. And then finally, you get the 7.1 that we use nowadays with three speakers in the front and then four channels on the surround. So we started by stereo with a sound image in the front. We moved to surround. Now everything on the sides, on the back, besides the front. The next step, it's immersive audio. When people talk about immersive or 3D or spatial audio, they are talking about surround with height component, which means that not only you have speakers around you in front and the sides and the back, but also you have speakers, for instance, above you, allowing you to explore the sound coming from above. Imagine that you are seeing a movie, there is a scene with a helicopter passing by, and you want that sound to come from above you. Using immersive format, you can now have this sense. And there are several formats. For instance, you have things like 7.1.2 that pretty much it's the traditional 7.1, three speakers on the front, four speakers, four channels around you, surrounds. But then you have two additional channels above you, a left and a right speaker above you on the ceiling, give you a sense of sound coming there. And then you have multiple other formats like 7.1.4. It's the exact same thing, but now with four speakers above you. So anytime that you see these formats with these three numbers, pretty much the first number is the number of speakers around you. The second is the number of LFEs, the subwoofers, and then the fourth one, the number of channels above you, usually an even pair, some on the left, some on the right. Besides these, there are also other immersive formats. You have things like Auro 3D 11.1 or 13.1. For instance, Auro 13.1, it's a 7.1 system, traditional system, and then with 5.0 above, slightly higher, with usually with an elevation around 30 degrees. And then they have this special speaker right above you called Voice of God, for obvious reasons, that allows to give all of this immersive experience. But there is other formats, IMAX 12.0, there is NHK 22.2. For instance, NHK 22.2 considers 9 speakers above you, then 10 speakers around you, 2 LFEs, and then 3 speakers in the front, but on the floor, to give a sense of sound also coming from the floor from below. So you have sounds around you, above you, and with 22.2, NHK, it's the Japanese broadcast station that created this format, allows you to also get the sense of sounds coming from the floor. Sometimes people also wonder, okay, but how does actually this panning in 3D works? How, when someone puts a sound in a particular direction, what happens? Well, it's pretty much like stereo. So with stereo, you have 2 speakers, and then depending on the gain that you send to each speaker, you can create a sense of a sound coming somewhere in the middle. When you this is used called vector-based amplitude panning, and what is done is to create, instead of 2 speakers, now we will use a triangle, which means that if I want a sound coming from that position somewhere in the middle of that triangle, I send the exact same sound for those 3 speakers, and then changing the gain, I'm able to change the position of the direction of the sound. So, channel-based audio, okay, what are the pros and cons? Well, the pros is that this is the perfect approach if you already know the layout that you are going to reproduce your sound. If you have a sound and you know, okay, I'm going to mix this, for instance, in 5.1, and every single time that I'm going to reproduce this is going to be in 5.1. It's not going to be in 7.1 or in stereo. No. If you already know the specific layout, then channel-based audio is the perfect format. Also, it doesn't need any kind of decoder because you are already creating the audio material that is going to be sent to every single speaker. Okay. What are the disadvantages? Well, if you really need different layouts, imagine that you have a movie that is going to be released in stereo, in 5.1, in 7.1. Actually, that means that you need to do now 3 mixes, one in stereo, another in 5.1, another in 7.1. So every time that you want to reproduce on the different layout, you need to remix everything. Of course, you can try to use up mixing and down mixing kind of tools, but once again, you never know exactly what you're going to have. So the problem with channel-based audio is that if you want to change the layout, you're going to have problems. If you don't want to change the layouts, okay, it's perfect, but it doesn't adapt to any layout. Which means that could it be any kind of format that would be able to adapt to this layout? Could we create a format that, okay, I'm mixing this in this format, but now this is going to be reproduced in different kinds of layouts without any kind of doing a new mix for that? Well, that's pretty much the goal of object-based audio and also of Amisonics that you're going to talk about during the next 2 videos. So stay tuned. And once again, don't forget about our free ebook, All You Need to Know About 3D Audio.